Welcome to Wine and Witchcraft. It's Thursday night, and tonight we're going to go walk in the woods and collect some plants. Everybody, it is Thursday night. We're back at it with Wine and Witchcraft, and we have a special show. It's awesome guests tonight. We're going to be talking about plant medicine magic, herbs, roots, all the stuff that has to do with herbs, plants, journeying with ayahuasca. Oh, yes, we have the ladies that have done it. So it's going to be a really, really good show. But let's start off talking about what everybody is drinking. So Justin, you go first.
Yes, I am in Portugal tonight. Oh. I am drinking... it's fresh and fruity, a white wine. I don't know, but it's good. It's like sparkling.
Alegrete.
So that's what I'm drinking.
All right. What is Anya and Amber drinking tonight?
Oh, we got some 2021 Estancia, California wine. It's a Merlot. So we're doing some red.
Ooh, yeah.
And where am I tonight? I'm in Argentina tonight drinking some Los Andes. Yes, we're having some Los Andes. All right, so let me introduce our guests real quick and then we'll go to the chat. So this is Amber and Anya. So Amber just started her YouTube channel not too long ago and her best friend Anya. So you guys want to say a little bit about yourself before we get started?
Sure, you want me to go first?
Yeah.
Okay, so hi. I grew up in Massachusetts. I'm 29, mother of three. Yeah, see, repping. I have been messing around with plant magic since my early 20s, maybe 23 or so. So a handful of years now. I'm an eclectic witch, I guess is what people call it. I call it the Krav Maga witchcraft. I just kind of, whatever's in front of me, I can use it. Oh no, I kind of feel like my ayahuasca journey and witchcraft are like intertwined. So it's really interesting to be here talking about it because it was the very reason why I started a YouTube channel was to talk about occult tea because we had the same thing going on in plant medicine community with like, you know, accountability and authenticity and all that. So,
right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah, you go.
Well, I guess it's my turn.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Anya, and I live and reside in New York. I come from a family of one of three. My parents came in from Cuba in 1992, so I was born here a couple years later. And I have been working with plant medicines for quite some time, about like 5 years or so. I've been working with the mother for about 5 years, facilitating and journeying with her in other plant medicines, such as combo as well, and mushrooms and acid and a little bit of that stuff. And I've kind of walked into my journey with witchcraft for a few years now. And okay. So I work and get messed with a little bit of different herbs and things of that nature. So I'm kind of like discovering my path a little bit.
I love that. I love that. I love when we have like one that's been there for a little while and the one that's kind of been there for a little bit, but a little while. I love that. That just makes it so magical. I love that time when like you're kind of new, but you're not really new. You're not really a baby witch. I don't even like to use that term, but a baby witch anymore, but you are, but you're not. So that is awesome. So now that we have the introductions out of the way, you already know who us are. Who us, yeah. You know who us are. Like that's proper English. Yeah. So we're going to go into the chat. Justin, you want to take away with the chat and tell us who's here?
Yes. Tonight? Hello, everyone. Let's see who's in the chat. Hugo 8-Track, of course, is number one as usual. Very excited. We have Owlvine. Mr. T is here. Yes. Chill time. It is chill time. Megan is here. Faye, my soul is here. Pagan Crafting. Faye, my soul. Okay. Let's come on here. What wine? What is everybody drinking? I think some people were already answering that. I think somebody's drinking whiskey. Yes, my hair. This wasn't a planned change, but here we are. We're embracing the darkness, the color of my soul.
We were just talking about that.
Thirsty Thursdays, honey. It is Thirsty Thursdays. Okay, so. Can we have a channel link? So the links are down below in the description. I did add them. So if you don't see it, you may have to like go out and come back in, but they are down there. And we have the smiling hag. Someone said something about my lipstick. I don't remember what it is. I'm sorry. It's some matte lipstick. And then I put on the Physician's Formula Diamond Plumper on top of it. So there you go. Say about that.
Well, this is my makeup from 6:30 this morning because this is what I wore to work and what I look like at work today. I literally got out of work, came in here. Here we are. It's a thing. So that's what this is. All right. So let's dive into it now that we have everybody in here.
Yes.
So when we talk about like using herbs and whatnot, people use them in so many different ways. I mean, like, the options are like endless. And I remember when I was getting new into witchcraft, like I felt like I had to have everything. Like I felt like you would open a book and it said, you need this, 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 and this, and this. And I'd be like, okay, I got to get like all these herbs, right? And then I soon realized that you really don't. But I do have quite a bit of herbs, but I have like my go-tos. And I think everybody has their go-tos. And I know, Amber, you were saying like, you're kind of like whatever's in front of you. Like if there's fucking coffee in front of you, you're going to grab it. If there's vodka in front of you, you're going to grab it. Like a lot of us are like that. Mm-hmm. I went to the garage. This is my old house. I went to the garage to go, I think I was going somewhere. I don't remember. And there was a dead cockroach in my garage. I picked that sucker up and I used that in a spell. And let me tell you, that dead cockroach, man, worked wonders. Okay. So I'm just saying, you use what you got. Okay. So I know that a lot of people use herbs in many different ways. So I kind of want to talk about some of the ways that you find yourself using the herbs the most. So Justin, if you want to start, where do you use herbs in your witchcraft?
Well, I'm a candle whore. Everybody, I think pretty much everybody knows that. So I'm a candle witch. That's how you want to identify. And I love dressing candles, fixing candles with herbs. I don't know. That's really the only time I use herbs. And I've actually gotten into the habit more so of using oils than I have herbs. So yeah, mainly like in waters, like in war water and stuff like that, I'll use herbs. But that's the main point I will use them. And then a lot of times I'll also use them. I learned this from Hoodoo Delish. I like to dress plates too with herbs, mm-hmm. You know, put the candle and then put all the herbs in there, mm-hmm. Which is a little excessive and I get that. but who cares? That's what right. I like to do.
Right.
So that's my favorite thing to do as far as like herbal magic is concerned. I haven't really delved too much into like tinctures and teas. It's something I've wanted to do, but I've never, it's always just been like, okay, I'll get to that eventually. I've never like made it to that point where I'm making my own teas or anything to that effect. But I know a lot of witches do make tinctures and stuff, which I think is fantastic. I don't know, something in my mind that sounds great, but I'm also lazy, so it never happens.
All right, what about you guys? Where do you find yourself using them the most?
Well, I use them. I use less now, but when I was heavily using herbs all the time, I would make like blessing bowls, I would call them. It's like I would take a bowl and I would put a ton of salt in it, and I would write like a petition, and depending if I want the thing to come towards me or move away from me is depending on how I would fold it. And then I would put certain herbs in the bowl with a candle, a tall candle burning on top, and kind of encapsulating it all if I can with the wax. I used to have like a cauldron with charcoal discs, and I used to really be into burning like the mugwort, the eye bright, all that stuff. Because that would just get me so lifted. But mainly now it's smoking. Like we've smoked blue lotus together and mugwort. Mugwort tea is fantastic too, if you want to have some dream stuff. But now it's more energy work that I'm doing. Like the herbs for me were more of a reminder to get into that space than necessarily having to need it to get to be in that energetic spell space, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it totally makes sense. What about you, Anya?
So I'm in the kind of in the same boat as well. I like to use different herbs. I like to use seashells as kind of a container as well, because I've been drawn into like working with Aphrodite and doing a lot of like self-love and prosperity and things of that nature. Recently, I did a bit of a hex on someone who wouldn't leave me alone. So
yes, girl. Yes,
get it. Embrace the darkness.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
You love a good hex.
Harassing me, but I was like, yeah, it's time. I don't like to do that, but I was like, can you just go away? So
yeah,
I was dabbling into that, being naughty, but yeah,
love it.
I wanted to ask you, ladies, so I know what I think about this, but this is a conversation that I think fits perfectly into this is we've talked previously, like in passing in other episodes about like working with the spirit of a plant, how do you guys feel about plants, and do you think everything has a spirit, has a soul? I think it's called animism. I think if I'm pronouncing it right, I could be pronouncing it incorrectly, but what is y'all's take on that? Like, do you feel like there's a spirit of connectivity? Do you feel like everything has a soul? Everything's like, where do you guys stand on that? I'm very interested to know.
Anything that has mass in this 3D realm, whether it's gas, water, solid, the energy that is making it vibrate, it has energy. Even if gases are all spread apart and moving slow, all of that is charged from source. That's how I experienced it. Everything comes from the same center. We are all one, essentially. So even to me, like this inanimate object can have a soul or a, well, not necessarily a soul, an energy to it anyway. But as far as living things, yes, all plants have souls and they all have energies and they all speak. Yeah.
Yeah. I feel that too.
Yeah.
I mean, that thing where they put, I don't know, like electrodes or whatever on ferns or whatever, and you listen to the music of the fern. Okay, I'm going to be completely honest. When I first saw it, I think it was like TikTok or Instagram, one of the reels, right? And I see it, I'm like, that's so pretty. But I'm like, that's got to be fake. Like, there's no way it can be that pretty. So I started actually researching this because, like, you know, a lot of things you see in, like, reels, you know, it's staged and fake or whatever. So I always do my research because you can't believe everything you see on the internet, especially in reels, because people stage that shit. And so I started doing my research, and no, that shit's real. Like, that shit, like, when they put it on leaves of a tree or a fern or a flower, like, what you're hearing is actually what's coming through. And that was just, like, a whole nother world for me. I'm like, oh, my God. And then, like, there's been times, Justin, you and I, where, remember we went on that nature walk in Mead Botanical Gardens and there was that one tree? Like, there's something about that tree that people probably pass by it, never even look at it, don't pay attention to it. And we're just, like, and we just stood there staring at it for, like, 10 minutes. Like, it was just one of those things, like, you know that there's got to be something going on. You know, as for me, I'll answer kind of both questions here. So as far as spirits in plants, absolutely. Because you got to think about it. Like, if you have a plant that starts as a seed and then it needs these resources such as soil, it needs light, you know, sunlight, it needs water to grow. What do we need to grow? The same kind of shit, right? So you're going to tell me that we're alive and we have spirits and we have souls, but something else that grows from nothing to something the same way we do? It kind of doesn't make any sense. So obviously the process of elimination, you have to kind of go with the fact that every living, breathing thing has some kind of energy, some kind of soul. And I use in air quotations because I'm not really sure if that's the right word. It's got that thing. I'm just going to say the thing. Why do you think we love to, you know, hug trees and go in nature? And why do you think that earthing is a thing? Where you take your shoes off and walk along the earth, you feel better. I mean, people have done research where they take their shoes off and walk on the grass and all of a sudden their arthritis is gone in their knees and their, you know what I mean, their joints, they're happier. It helps depression. Why do you think that people who deal with seasonal depression go under UV lamps? You know? So that's my kind of answer to that. I think everything kind of has to. If you don't believe in that, you're basically believing, like, you're like an earth flat person. You think the earth is flat. You're just, you know, you're not all there. So that's my thought with that. Now, the other thing as far as using herbs and what I use them for, it's kind of the same as Justin. I bring a lot of hoodoo into my magic. So I do a lot of the fixing of the candles. I do put them on plates and stuff like that. But I've also put them in spell jars, which I've done one for someone at work before. I did a sweetening jar. And I did it. It's like a little jar. And I actually put it, because we have so many like pockets in our scrubs, I put it in one of my many pockets in my leg and has a zipper on it. And I made sure that I walked into this lady's office with it in my scrub pocket at least like 3 or 4 times during the day. Like, I had to be in the vicinity of her with this sweetening jar in my scrubs. So, and it worked. Oh my God. It went a little weird, but it worked. Needless to say, she doesn't work there anymore. Anyway. So, you know, I've done them in jars. I've also done them in dream bags where I take, you know, those little sachet bags that you can see through. I'll put a whole bunch of shit in there, shit that I'm connected to, shit that I feel vibrates with me, things that are speaking to me. I'll throw them all in there. I will consecrate it. And I'll put that shit underneath my pillow. I've done things where I put them in my car. When I bought a brand new car, I hung it from the rearview mirror. So I will use herbs in any way, any shape, any form I can. As for teas, abso-fucking-lutely. Look, girl, I'm half British, so we love our tea. So I will make mugwort tea. I will have lavender tea, chamomile. I'll just sometimes even just put shit in there that's probably not even supposed to be in there and drink it. Look, that's just me. So that's kind of how I use it.
I guess okay. So I'm alone. It's okay. I don't know how I feel about it because let me just say. I think it stems from my indoctrination because, you know, in Christianity, well, at least in the cult that I grew up in, you're taught that nothing has a soul but people. So I think a part of that is something that I'm holding on to. I do believe that everything has an energetic source and something that can be tapped into, obviously, otherwise I wouldn't use herbs. I don't know that it's a spirit. Like, to me, like the and maybe it's the terminology. I'm a Virgo. Okay. I'm just analytical.
You're analytical. Yep.
But I see energy and spirit as like a different like vibration, I guess you can say. And I do know. Like, as of right now, I don't feel like plants have spirits because to me, I think if a plant has a spirit, if I'm crushing it up and burning it, then aren't I killing it? Like, I don't get it. Yeah, but that's just me. I'm not saying that I'm right. I'm very much a person that I'm probably wrong about a lot, but I just don't feel like it has the term spirit or soul. I think it has an energetic force, but I also think it goes into like this idea of like, what is it called? An egregore? Like if everybody's talking about basil for, you know, making your pussy wet, and it, over generations we use it for that, then obviously that's what it's going to be used for. And we're all feeding into it. So that's what it's going to do. Like, I know I'm probably wrong and everyone hates me. I'm used to it. I don't care. I just don't think it has a spirit. Like, I don't know if I even think animals have a spirit. Ooh, there's the thesis. I don't know. I could be, and again, I could be wrong. I'm not saying I'm right. I've been fucked up most of my life. I'm being recalled, so that's going to be what it is. Yes, basil is used to make your vagina moist. That's what it's used
so, over here. If one person believes it, it's true. It only takes right? one.
Everything's valid.
us as humans who are mammals, we are animals. We're no different than any other mammal on this planet. We're just more intelligent in a lot of ways. You're telling me that we're the only mammal that has a spirit of sorts? It has energy?
Let me just again clarify. I'm not saying I'm right. You can believe whatever you want to believe. That has no effect on my life at all. I just don't necessarily, but like I do believe that plants obviously have an energetic force. Like there is, like there's scientific evidence of that. I think that that's 100% true. I just don't know that I equate that to like a spirit. Like
why are you fixing candles with herbs? What is their reasoning before it then?
Because there's an energetic force that I feel like people have fed into through an egregore. And so that plant is associated with that. And you're more so, to me, I view it more as a sympathetic magic. Like the collective people use, say, you sage for protection. And everybody's of that mindset. Everybody's feeding into that. So that plant over time has been programmed to associate with that sort of energy, that protective energy. So that's what it does. And you're tapping into that more so. I think I view it kind of like deity. Like if you look at Santa Muerte or Hecate, they've been around, well, Hecate specifically for millennia. Like we don't know her origin. We just know modern day what we associate her with. And that's what we tap into. That doesn't necessarily mean for millennia that that's what she stood for. Maybe at one time she was the goddess of the hearth. We factually don't know that. So that's kind of how I look at it.
I look at it as like the universal laws. So like micro and macro, mm-hmm. As above, so below. So I don't know. I just see it as, I see it definitely more as energy than a spirit, though with certain plants and fungi I've definitely sensed a spirit that was speaking to me. Mm-hmm. But I do like half agree with your thought there, because I don't necessarily feel that lavender has a spirit for me when I work with it. It has an energy and it has a vibe, but I haven't connected to lavender to the point where I felt lavender has spoken to me.
Right.
You know, unless feeling the intuition of what lavender is used for, is it speaking to me? So.
Yeah. And like I said, I'm probably wrong. I'm not saying I'm right.
I don't think anybody's really wrong, though. I think that we just feel and see things in a very different way. And I think that everybody's kind of right. Because if you really think about all of our answers, they all kind of meet somewhere and go like this. So in a sense, nobody's really wrong. I just think that y'all are flat earthers. No, I'm just kidding. So I want to talk about.
No.
So I want to talk about some of the herbs that we are drawn to in our practice. Justin, do you want to go first? So what some of that your go-to grab tos are?
Yeah. So some. Did you want me to like show them or just tell you?
You can if you want to. You do you, boo. This is why I witchcraft. We don't have any rules.
Okay, so my favorite herb is not going to be a surprise to anybody if you watch my channel, and if you don't, then who are you? but coffee is my favorite herb. Coffee is my favorite. I love, 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 love. Yes, everything's open to personal interpretation.
Yes.
And if you disagree with me, you're wrong. So coffee is my favorite. I love it for speed, to speed up everything, to energize it. I love it when I'm working with deity, saint work, anything where I feel like I want action to happen. So sometimes I feel like when I sit at my Hecate altar, she's kind of like not in the mood. And I'll, you know, give a little coffee, or if I'm trying to talk to my ancestors, a little coffee, you know, give a little energy to the situation. And specifically if I'm doing something for protection or money work, I will use coffee. Again, just a little disclaimer, fast doesn't always mean good. It's just like sex. Do you want it good or do you want it fast? They don't always go together. You know what I mean? So just keep that in mind. You never know how it's going to turn out. Sometimes you finish, sometimes you don't. The other one that I love to do, that I like to add, is nutmeg. A lot of these I think are more hoodoo based, because that's kind of more of what I draw inspiration from. But nutmeg I like to add for success. I just feel like it's a good push to bring in that successful aspect to a spell, to see it through to the end. So nutmeg is another good one that I love. And then what else do I got over here? I love chamomile. If I'm doing protection, even hexing, money work, anything like that, I am somebody who just feels like I want the working to go through as calmly and peacefully for everybody as possible. Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't want to get the money in some dramatic way, or, you know, I don't want someone to be hexed or push somebody away in like a dramatic way. Like, let it seem natural, let it flow easy, let it seem like it's all on the up and up. So chamomile is lovely. And I do love a good chamomile tea. Mm-hmm. Not gonna lie. And then we're just going to do the basic witchery. I mean, who doesn't love bay leaves? I mean, come on now. Like, yes. This is everything. I mean, you can just write on a bay leaf, burn it, good for protection, good for luck, good for everything. Like, this is just a versatile bitch right here. Like, versatile right here. Okay. And so those are some of my favorites.
Okay. What about you guys? What are some of your go-tos, things you've had to replenish over and over because you use the shit out of them?
Ooh, well, back in the day when I was using a lot, I'll go with those ones. Eye Bright was huge for me for mental clarity. Mugwort, wormwood, valerian root, which I love in tincture form with blueberry vodka specifically. It covers the taste, but that's for anxiety. St. John's wort was a big favorite of mine. One of the roots that I remember I loved carrying on me, because I had a lot of problems with exes, and I'm not really sure why it worked, but it was St. John the Conqueror. I remember carrying that around with me all the time.
Girl, I really loved that one. Yes.
And just like you, Justin, I use lavender and chamomile in about all of my works to ensure that it's as smooth and sweet and easy as possible. Because some of my magics, if I'm not careful, it's like an explosion goes off.
Yes.
So, yeah. What about you?
Oh, well. Well, I've dabbled a little bit. I'm still kind of new to it all. I love working with essential oils.
Mm-hmm, me too.
Candles. I love salt. I love water. I love bay leaves, chamomile, mugwort, rose, lavender, cinnamon, because I used a lot of cinnamon for a lot of
cinnamon. Yes.
You may want to look into orchid too.
Yes.
You may want to try some orchid flowers too. I don't know if you've tried orchid flowers, but they're really good. You should look into that.
Yes.
Ooh, definitely will.
Yeah, we've definitely smoked some herbal like blends. Joints. Yeah, used to make blends like flowers, like roses, jasmine, lavender.
Lotus. Mm-hmm. I actually also put a little bit of sage in there too. Gives it a nice high, but without the brain fog, and it was so delightful.
Mm-hmm.
I love that you brought up water. And I know this is like plant herb whatever we're doing here, but I love that you brought up water because yep. I'm going to be the first one to tell you, when I was first coming back to my practice, even before, I never used water. It wasn't until I started reading more about hoodoo and how important and how invigorating water is, not just to feed spirit, but to also amplify a working, like doing a fixed candle, putting in a bowl of water, like honey, the amplification, like do not sleep on the power of water. Like, I'm so glad you brought that up.
That is actually a really, really good one. I agree. So mine that I use, some of them are overlapping, which y'all have already said, but actually only one of them I think actually overlaps. But wormwood, yes, honey. Love me some wormwood. I use this a lot around Samhain. And I remember when I first started looking into this herb, the biggest things they were saying is like, do not eat it. Bitch, I ate this shit. you know, good fun fact that people probably know, but some may not, is that this is what absinthe is made out of. So, you know, I was like, I want to put it in my wine. So I used to like, you know, heat this up with some boiling water and make kind of like a, you know, like, you know, poor white girl fucking, you know, tincture out of it and pour it in my wine. It doesn't taste great. I'm going to tell you right now, it's bitter as fuck. But yeah, I totally fucking ate it. They told me not to. You know, I'm also the kid that ate the glue in second grade when they told us not to. So, yeah, that's me. So the other one is actually eucalyptus. This one I use all of the time. So this one is really good for protection. When you got to protect yourself or your house or anything, eucalyptus is great. I also love like showering with this. Oh my God, when you get the steam and the hot water on this shit. You know, I think like a lot of us as kids had eucalyptus around the house when we get colds and shit. Great for that, but it's also great for healing and protection. So that's another one I use all the time. Okay, so Samhain is, you know, also one of like everybody's favorite sabbats, right? And one of the biggest herbs around that time of year is calendula. And I'll be the first to admit that I used to call this calendula because I'm stupid. So I would call it calendula. But it's, you know, great for protection, prophetic dreams, legal matters, psychic powers associated with Samhain. It's really kind of universal. You can use this for a lot of shit. But I mean, who doesn't like marigolds and calendula? Okay, now we're going to get into the dark shit where I hex a bitch. So, you know, I use a lot of cayenne pepper. You know, if I don't like a bitch, you're getting cayenne pepper, okay? And girl, this is fucking like, you know, your grocery store shit. Like, you don't need no fancy shit. This is fucking from the grocery store. I get the organic just because, you know, I don't know where all the other stuff has been. Probably up Justin's ass, but you never know. So I get the organic cayenne. Bitch, this shit's fucking spicy as fuck. And I've used two of these already because, I mean, you start fucking being a bitch, I'm going to hex you. Okay, and the other one, chilies, straight up fucking chilies. And you can find this in the Hispanic section, a lot of grocery stores, especially down south here in Florida. I will just, you know, put this in a lot of different things. I will crush it up and put it in candles. I will carry it on me. Don't carry it on your bare legs because it will burn you. Anyway, so yes, anytime you want to do some naughtiness, anything spicy is a good thing. Yes, I like all those kind of naughty things. So those are kind of my go-tos that I've had to kind of replenish on the regular. And there was one point in time where I found myself using so much cayenne and chilies that I was like, all right, I need to like isolate myself because quite frankly, I'm getting too pissed off at everybody. So I'm using too much of my naughty herbs, but there's that.
I'm glad you mentioned that because I did write that down, but I didn't grab it. I love, and a good thing also with cayenne and the pepper itself is good. Even if you're not hexing, like if it's a lust spell or a love spell, you can bring in that heat, that passion. If you want to up your sex life, whatever it is, you can add that in there. Whoo, bring on the heat. So Megan did ask, what do you use orchid flowers for? And Owlvine did answer that. I was looking to see, I don't know where. So I use it a little bit differently, and I'm going to tell you that. I was looking in the Hoodoo Urban Root Magic book. I didn't see it in there, so I'm not sure where I got this from. I may have just come up with it on my own. But it is listed in Scott Cunningham's book, and it, you know, it's for love, basically. I don't really use it that way. So to me, an orchid is beautiful but deadly. And that's not necessarily true. That's just how I view it. So I like to add orchid if I'm doing some sort of baneful magic and I want it I'm someone who believes that if, say, I'm hexing somebody or I'm doing something baneful, and say it's another practitioner, I want them to be sweet to the idea. Like, I don't want them to really be aware of it. And I feel like the orchid adds some delusion of sweetness. I think it hides the working a little bit. So that's where I come up with that sweet but deadly aspect when it comes
orchid to orchid. Also is easy to kill as far as like trying to keep it in your house and take care of it. I've had quite a few orchid plants that I've totally killed because they're very delicate. So you have that like energy of delicate in there too, easily breakable, easily like can die, because I can't keep an orchid alive. And I know there's a lot of people that same way, they love orchids and they buy them and they're like, I can't keep this shit alive. So there's that.
I'm just realizing that's one of my like secret ingredients and I just said it. So
you know, when you said that, I'm like, girl, I know everything about you and you didn't tell me that shit. You also didn't tell me you dyed your hair brown either, but you know, that's the thing.
Well, I didn't tell anybody, honey.
Yeah, so Justin had blonde hair like, what was it, 14 hours ago?
Literally, and I was touching up my roots, and I didn't get a purple base. I got a blue, and it was a brand I hadn't used before. And my one that I normally use, I can leave on for like 30 minutes. And I left this one on for 30 minutes, and my hair turned like this dingy, blue, yellow, disgustingness. And I have a friend who's a cosmetologist, and I reached out to her. She gave me a suggestion. I went to Sally's, got this like shimmer thing, didn't help, so I had to cover it. So the blonde's gone for now, but you know what? It's okay.
It's all good. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about real quick is the herbs that you do not own, have never used, have never had in your repertoire, what they are, and how do you want to use them if you know how? Some people just kind of want them, but they don't really know how they want to use them. But what herbs kind of intrigue you that you've never used before in your practice? Justin, you go first.
Well, I just have a few, and they're not all herbs. So one is belladonna, orris root, which I do have orris root. I just haven't used it yet. The other one I really, really want to use, and it's not an herb, but graveyard dirt. I've never used graveyard
dirt. Wow, I thought you had.
I've never used it. I've always wanted it, but I've just, again, laziness. And then I'm just trying to like capitulate how I want to like incorporate that. But those are some of the things that I would like to use. I just haven't yet.
What about you guys?
Ooh, so for me, I've actually never worked with Angelica root. And I've been feeling really called to work with that. I don't know, for protections. I'm not really sure what the prescribed meanings are. Cat's claw, I've been wanting to work with too. Actually, you have cat's claw? Yeah. Oh, hell yeah. and then let me think of one more. Oh, bone set. We have a lot of bone set that's wild around here in New York and Pennsylvania. And I'd be interested in using it in magical works. Definitely, I know there's jimson weed too. So around here somewhere. So I would love to work with that. Yeah. How about you?
So I actually, there was this one herb that I was really interested about. It's called Epe Obo, which helps with, it's like an anti-witchcraft. So like if anyone's trying to throw hexes or any energy at you, it kind of like reflects it. So I've always been really interested in that. I actually grabbed some the other day and just trying to like work with its energy and understand it a little bit, how I can use it in my spells.
Well, I kind of like that. What is it called again? I want to find some. What is it?
It's Epe Obo, E-P-O-O-B-E-E.
E-P.
Yeah.
How do you spell it?
Epe, E-P, I think it's E-P-O-O-B-E. Epe Obo, or EPO? I think I'm saying it right. Hopefully I'm spelling it right.
Let me see if I can do a quick search.
Yeah.
I gotta find it.
It is a tree bark from
We all are looking that up. Maybe it's mugwort. So you can do a mugwort tea. You can burn mugwort. You can get an essential oil. It's a little pricey for mugwort, and it's good for guidance, for dreams, for trance work. Like, it's really intense. So definitely try that. And then get in the car and drive.
Yeah.
No, don't do that.
It's also called gutta percha. It's a tree bark from Nigeria used for negativity, spirits, and unwanted energies.
All right,
it's also used in voodoo, it says. So.
Yeah, okay.
You keep the evil eye away, so maybe that might be cool.
Yeah.
I need to get me some of that. Yes, honey.
Yeah.
All right. So some of the herbs that I do not have that I've never used that I would love to use in my practice at some time in the future is foxglove, blue lotus, which you ladies have experience with. And I've had it like in my cart and Etsy and Amazon and so many different places. And I never like jump off the cliff and buy it. I don't know why. Blue lotus is another one. Agarwood. I want to use saffron, but it's so fucking expensive.
It is, girl, I'm glad you said that. I look at when I go to Publix, I always look at it and I'm like, it's a little tiny thing and it's like $17.
Okay, I'm a witch on a budget. But saffron like has so many awesome things and I don't want to spend the money on it, but I really, really want to try it sometime. And the other one actually was something that Justin used a long, long, long time ago. And I was always been so intrigued by it. And this is back when you were a newbie witch, baby witch, whatever word you want to call it, newcomer. I don't know, whatever label you want to slap on. And you were new to the path. Vespa powder. I love Vespa powder. Oh, bet. And you almost, didn't you like almost burn your house down using it?
Okay, there was this, like two story, Brittany never got to go here in Lakeland. And it was like an old like thrift store in a building that was basically falling down, but it had a little witchy area in there. And I just saw Vesta powder and I thought, okay. And when I went to check out, the lady was like, just be careful with this because it's flammable. And I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever. It is. Okay. And so you had my little charcoal desk and I knew it was like to cleanse an area, like to get rid of negative shit, right? So I just took a big old spoonful, threw that bitch on there and whoosh, lit on fire. My whole apartment was full of smoke. I had to open up all the windows. Use it with discretion because holy shit.
Yeah, every time you told me about that story, and I remember I was dying laughing because you're like, I think I burned my eyebrows off. I think I have no eyebrows. I don't know what happened. I remember asking you if you're okay and then dying laughing for a good hour. Like, because you know how when someone tells you a story, you get like this mental image, like this plays out in your head, and there's just the whole like, whoosh, I have no eyebrows.
That shit lights up.
My Lilith altar did the same thing. I had a tiny little tea light went over it and whoosh. She must have been very unhappy with me. But yeah.
Jesus. I don't think I've ever come close to burning down my house, but I'm very anal retentive with like candles and any kind of fire magic. I mean, I'm very anal retentive about it, but I don't think I've ever done that. But now that I know that you use a pinch, like literally a pinch, I so want to use it at some point. I'll obviously have my windows open because I don't know how it's going to react. But you know, with charcoal, a lot of us burn our herbs on charcoal at some point in our practice, if we not all the time. Mm-hmm. And you know, a lot of people were saying resin too. People use a lot of tree resins and stuff to burn on their charcoal. And look, as witches, we all love that shit. Come on. We love to burn a good herb or a good resin. But I heard a lot of things about charcoal. Some of them probably true. Some of them a stretch of the truth. But, you know, the whole idea of the saltpeter in the charcoal, not really great for you, whatever. But I vape, so like, whatever. My lungs are shit anyway. But anyway, so, you know, I kind of was like, I want to find an alternative to, you know, using charcoal. So I got one of those, like, you put the tea light in it and it's got the stick with the thing you put down and up, and you put aluminum foil in it and then you put your herbs or your resins top of it. So you're not using charcoal, but you can move it up and down according to the heat of your tea light. And that makes it last a lot longer. The scent is more true to what you're actually burning or heating up. So those of you out there that kind of like the charcoal, but kind of want to get away from the charcoal, that might be an alternative for you. I also find that charcoal, if you're going to use it and that's really what you're, you know, used to and you want to use it, put aluminum foil on top of the charcoal, then put your herbs or your resins, and it won't really burn up as fast. Because I find with charcoal, the heat is so intense with those that you put a little bit of herbs or a little bit of resin on there, and poof, it's gone in like 3 seconds. And it's like, what the fuck? And you got to keep on adding more. Aluminum foil is your best friend, whether it be the little thingy, I don't know what it's called, the little pole thingy, or, you know, if you use charcoal, try aluminum foil on top of it, little trick. But anyway, so, you know, as far as herbs, I know you guys are talking in the chat in the audience about different herbs that you guys really like to use, different ones you've never used. Mistletoe, that is a really good one. Never really used that or thought about that one. That's a really, really good one.
My mom just asked about datura. Mama, don't mess with datura. No. I love you. That's what scopolamine comes from. Datura. No, it puts you in a very lucid, malleable state. It's really dangerous.
Yeah. And you'll be tripping.
And you could die.
Yeah. I knew someone that actually drank some of the tea, and they were tripping for 16 hours straight. Nothing but like nightmarish hallucinations.
And sometimes they don't come back.
Yeah. So totally don't recommend.
Yeah, a lot of poison plant stuff is very dangerous. Like belladonna. Mm-hmm. I know some people have microdosed and stuff, but a lot of that stuff you're playing with fire.
Yeah.
Because we don't know how you'll react personally. Yeah, so.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm gonna get a whole big thing of it and take it all. I always said I want to die on alive. So if someone's going to kill me, make sure I can go live first. Go out with a bang.
Fall over his chair. Blink.
Just fall over. Exactly.
So, you know, now that we've talked about herbs a little bit, and now that Anya and Amber are kind of talking about, you know, those naughty herbs and whatnot, things not to do, we're going to kind of cycle a little bit out of just standard magical herb talk, and we're going to talk about those herbs that do give you that experience and where that kind of weaves into your witchcraft. Because I think we did an episode with Miss Owlvine. Was that last season? That was last season, wasn't it?
We did a
weed magic using marijuana in your practice, where you can use it and where it benefits you. And that show was probably one of the funnest and funniest episodes we've ever done, because we were all stoned out of our minds. And when we look back at it, when we rewatch that episode, if you've not watched it, go back at last season 3, and look at it. It's absolutely fucking hysterical, because we're all stoned out of our mind in that episode. Yeah,
I need to, let me look. It's called Witches Under the Influence. We were drunk. We were high. It was a fucking shit show.
Honestly, it was great.
I think it's one of, I have to look now to see so I can tell them. I think it's one of my favorite episodes we've ever done, because it was just a complete and utter shit show. So season 3, episode 16. And I did want to say this too, because we've got a lot of new people in here. If you go on the channel page, we do have playlists for each season, so you guys can like quickly find stuff. So it's season 3, episode 16 is Witches Under the Influence, if you're in for a good laugh.
I mean, even if you don't even dabble in that and you just watch the episode, it's absolutely hysterical. It reminds me of like the Afro Man song, you know, I was going to do a live, but then I got high. Because we all had this plan, like, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. And like, I remember like we had these plans and now we got high and we can't do this show. I'm so stoned. I don't even know how to talk anymore. It was fucking great. It was fucking, because I had gone back to Massachusetts for a funeral. It feels like anytime I go back to Massachusetts for someone died. But I went back home for a funeral, and last time I was back home before that funeral, you know, weed was illegal. When I grew up there, it was illegal, right? So going back home to Boston and everything was legal, it was just like a mind fuck for me and my husband. So we're like, well, we'll go to a dispensary, see what it's all about, because we all, you know, did it. And I was like, well, let's get some shit, you know, whatever. We're here because someone died. It sucks. So let's, you know, get high. So we bought some stuff, and I had like, you know, a very strong strain of weed in that vape pen. And let me tell you, I was not prepared at all for that show.
I don't mess with that flower yep. only.
Yeah.
It was, I was like, oh, I'll just get a little tiny hit. And I was like sitting there when we went to go start the show. I was the one that had to open the show. And I sat there like, what?
Yeah, and I tried to like run the intro and then I made the background go away. I put it in the comments so you guys check it out when this episode's over. It's a good laugh.
Oh, it was one of my favorite. But anyway, there's more than weed, right? There is so much more. And I think that, you know, Florida is going to become next on the list of being legalized because it's already medical here. And now, you know, it's really, I just want to say that it's really difficult for a lot of us who grew up in, were born in the 80s and grew up in the 80s and 90s to kind of get our brain out of like the illegal thing, you know? That's
the paranoia is real.
Hard mind. Because we used to, you know, have to like go to our dealers and get a dime bag. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have, we're going into a dispensary in Boston. We're like, what the fuck is this shit? You know, same thing in Las Vegas when I went to go see my friend Nina, who's in the chat here, Dreamtime Tarot. We're just walking down the strip and it just smells like weed everywhere, but it's just like fucking normal, you know? And it's when you grow up, you know, when you're, you know, in the 80s, 90s, even the early 2000s, it's just kind of like, it's a mind fuck because you're used to it being illegal, you know? Mm-hmm. But anyway, beyond all that, I'm going to kind of turn the show a little bit over to Anya and Amber because they have been through some journeying in witchcraft with a lot of psych medicine, witchcraft, a lot of psych medicine, herbs and plant magic. So if you guys want to talk about your journeying, what you were on, what you used, all those kinds of things, I'm sure that the fans and the audience can have a lot of questions about what you guys have been through. If you can kind of explain it in the best way you possibly can.
I'm just going to say something real quick just to cover all bases here. We are not condoning usage of any herbs. We are not medical professionals. So you do whatever you want to do at your own will. This is just sharing personal experiences. I just wanted to put that disclaimer out there. We did the same thing with witches under the influence. Journey at your own risk, okay?
Absolutely. So kind of take the floor and talk about that a little bit. Like, you know, start from the beginning for those who are kind of unknowledgeable about any of it, you know, let them know what it's all about, like how your experience was. Did you have, when you were on it, did you have someone there to make sure that everything went okay? All those kinds of things. Share your whole entire experience with us and why you decided to take that leap off the cliff.
All right. So I have a list of herbs that between me and her, we have sat with some only she has sat with some, maybe some, I don't know if you've had honey mead. It's not a big thing, but we're probably,
oh, really delicious.
Yeah. We're probably going to focus basically. I wanted to really touch on the ayahuasca and then on mushrooms. If we can, we're probably just going to be in the ayahuasca because there's a lot, and there's a lot of other herbal medicines that are happening. The ayahuasca ceremony as well. So I'm going to just list off our list so y'all know. So if you have any questions and we don't get to something, DM me. And if I don't have an experience, I can have you speak to Miss Anya about it. But so between the two of us, ayahuasca, combo, which is the frog medicine, frog poison, mushrooms, trippy and medicinal or gourmet, cactus. Anya has sat with cactus, mm-hmm. Sassafras tea, mambe leaves, which is coca leaves, cacao for full moon ceremonies, mapacho and jape, which are two different forms of ceremonial tobacco, salvia, kava kava, kratom, sananga, which is eye drops, which is used during ceremony as well, honey mead, and then blue lotus and other smokable plants. But we're probably just going to focus on ayahuasca, combo, jape, mapacho, and then sananga. Mm-hmm. That's sound good? Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to kind of ramble, and then I'll probably pass it on to you, and then you can ramble.
Okay.
I'm going to put a disclaimer right now. I'm going to be talking about mental health. In no way do I recommend anybody to journey with psychic or psychedelic plant medicines, for mental health reasons. However, that is usually the reason why most people come to plant medicine. Mm-hmm. So it's a dual thing. I don't recommend it. However, usually that's the main reason. Also, disclaimer, please, please, if you're going to work with a plant medicine or woman, you need to vet them really, yes, really well. Yes.
Yeah.
I can't go into specifics for safety reasons. However, the person who was in charge of ceremonies, that the one ceremony that I went to, I'll speak for me, it was not done properly. It was not safe, and it was scary as fuck. And Grandmother Ayahuasca won. She came through, and her message won through the darkness, but it was a lot of unnecessary darkness for Western people who did not get initiated properly facilitating and giving medicine. So it was a big, like, shadow shit pop. However, amazing shit happens. So still, you can still have an amazing experience. It's just, you're going to do it, please do it properly. And I suggest spending more money and going down to South America to a shaman in a shack type situation. because they've been doing this their whole life and they know the medicine. And
it's interesting that you said that, because I'm gonna let you tell your story, but I didn't know anything about ayahuasca. Mm-hmm. Until I was on Netflix and I watched Chelsea Handler's, like, Chelsea Does, and she did ayahuasca, and I was like, that is intense. Like, that seems wildly intense to do.
Like, even now as I'm speaking, I can feel like my energy raising and my breathing. It's like going back to that space, but it's an incredible space. So I came to ayahuasca at a very bad mental state, suicidal, you know, it just didn't know what to do with my life. And through friends who have all been a part of ceremonies, there was a spot available that weekend. It was like, you're gonna do this. And I didn't have time to diet. You're supposed to have a special diet. You're supposed to not be on absolutely anything. I'd smoked weed like maybe a week prior. So those things do affect it. Like, you can't have had St. John's wort and do ayahuasca. You can die. Yeah. It's
no.
Yeah, there's a lot of weird interactions that can happen. So when I went to a ceremony, the first night, it was a 2-night ceremony, a full weekend. And during the days, we would take the ayahuasca at night, sit in ceremony, have the experiences. And then during the days, we focus on integration, which was mainly just participants talking. There was about 10 to 12 participants. And the first night was Chakruna. And I've been saving this. I didn't mention this to any of you guys because I kind of wanted to shock you a little bit. So my first night with Chakruna, I didn't necessarily elevate to the highest realm. That happened the second night. However, I am not raised with any Christian background. My mother is a witch, my biological father is a witch, and then the people that raised me, atheists. Mm-hmm. And so I was actually always like pushed away from Christianity, like it was made fun of. So I never had that paradigm. It was always like very spiritual or very logical. And I work with the Morrigan. And I remember the Morrigan was there with me right up to the moment when I walked into ceremony. And she looked around, and even though she said nothing, and this is all third eye, so I know I sound crazy. This is just me and my deities communications. She looked around and it was almost like disappointment. But not disappointment. It was kind of like, well, if you're going to do this, you're going to do this. And she pushed me and she said, you'll find an honorable God in there. And I will say this, the plant medicine person was very eclectic. She claims South American, African, and Hawaiian tradition. She was not initiated in any of those. So there was a lot of energies happening. And I don't know if it was subliminal messaging that maybe triggered my experience, but I was crucified biblically accurately beside Jesus. and it happened for what felt like eternity. Any person who had ever hurt me in my life did a wound, and it was infinite until I could look at them and feel nothing but love for them. And it wasn't until I felt that I looked to my side and I saw Jesus was crucified right next to me. And we couldn't speak. We were in lots of pain. And I was crying tears of blood. He was crying tears of blood. And then I felt my heart like explode through these thorns, which I guess is accurate to the mythos. I'm not sure. And right. I just felt totally embraced. And I'm not a Christian witch in any way. Like Jesus is my weed buddy. I know that sounds really weird. He comes around when I smoke weed. But you know, not really active as far as like doing witching with him, but definitely a whole vibe, a whole like chill vibe of going through something with somebody and just being like, yeah, we did that, but we're still here. So that was like shocking to me. And I think the medicine showed me that because it felt like, I don't know, it got into my psyche, into my soul, and it knew that I needed that experience to expand my perspective and awareness, because I felt that I was shut off from that tradition. Not that I wanted to be in, but I just felt like, oh, I'm a witch. I was not raised around that. That's not even possible for me to connect with that energy. So that was crazy. Ayahuasca really is like death training. You're releasing all the ick from yourself, energies that aren't yours, energies that are like these patterns and programs. You're literally throwing it up and shitting it out. Like I was throwing up snakes and shitting out rainbows. I shit you not, speaking Spanish. You lose your damn mind on it. And it's ecstasy, it's bliss. That's what the other side feels like. It's just pleasure, pain. There is no division. It's just an experience and a feeling. And the second night was Chalipanga, which I found out through some research is like more of a Colombian style brew. And it does affect people, some people much more strongly. It rocked our shit. I was convinced Russia had bombed us. My ego was so afraid to let go and to die that I was walking around. I had left ceremony space because it had gotten too intense. There was a lot of sexual energy coming out in other participants. So it got a little dark. And I went downstairs and just kind of anchored it out for everybody. And I just took all that darkness and just tried to stay steady and solid for everybody. And if it wasn't for her being there, I would have lost my mind. Because she was facilitating and actually not under any influence. Mm-hmm. So the second I knew that she seen me, I was like, you see me? I was like, I'm not dead. I was like, okay, we're good. But it was very, very, it brought a lot of integration to me. I can't really even describe fully like where we went and what happened because it's so much, it's so detailed, it's so intense. It was the realest thing of my life besides giving birth to my children. The most real thing I've ever experienced. And honestly, it made me see things in such a way that it's like pulling the curtain back in the Wizard of Oz. It's like you see the patterns, you see the whole picture, and you're a part of the whole picture. And it just kind of blew open my perspective of like with my mental health, you know, the way I view things, my depression, my anxiety, the way that I can transmute energies now and see things for what they really are. And now there are long-term effects, like to this day, when I look at people, it's not really like I can see their face. It's like I can see the energy that's flowing within them. You know, it's weird. It's weird, but definitely incredible. And during ayahuasca ceremony, they use multiple medicinal herbs. One of them is jape, or rape, depending on what part of South America you come from. And it's a tobacco snuff mixed with a ritual tree ash bark. It varies depending on what tribe you're getting it from. But it essentially grounds you out. Like they call it grandmother ayahuasca and grandfather tobacco. And I really feel like it brings you down a few notches, like when you're deep in ceremony and things are really intense. It like grounds you. It brings it down a little bit when it's too much for you to handle, because everything is fractal. Everything is like an Alex Gray artwork. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely surreal. You can see the flower of life on anything that's living.
Because you're literally drinking like liquid DMT.
Like you can see the flower of life in the brew itself.
Wow.
In the rainbow. It's very ethereal. So they give that to you in a hape in a tepe, which is like a long like bone, hollow bone, or it could be wood. I use a kudape, which I actually have a piece of ayahuasca on this kudape. That is ayahuasca.
Oh.
That is the ayahuasca vine. Yeah. And that's how you give yourself hape. You can self-serve using this, a kudape. They also offer sananga, which is some type of plant. I'm not sure of the plant. It's called jaguar eye drops.
Yes, but it's used from the venom of wasps.
Oh, that's why I burn like a bitch.
Yes.
Oh.
So I know a person that was using it because they had glaucoma in their eyes, and they actually healed glaucoma. Entirely.
It heals styes too. Yeah. If you get styes, I know somebody that it was Eliza. She had to get a ton of surgeries, and mm-hmm. she used sananga, and it helped.
Yes.
But they use that. They have you lay on your back, put it in, hurts like a son of a bitch, and you're blinking, crying. But when you finally open your eyes, everything is so crystal clear, like more crystal clear than you could ever imagine.
Yes.
Visuals being, and your mind is very clear too. Mm-hmm. And then the last thing they offer is combo, which I have no experience with combo because I was on my moon cycle, and you do not take combo when you're on your period.
If your practitioner tries to give you combo on your moon cycle, that's a red flag, because women should not be taking combo at all. It's very highly against the cultural norm in the jungle and other tribes.
But you can talk about your combo
because experience. The woman itself, I think it's because she's grounding, and combo kind of like is a purgant, so it purges everything from your guts to your bile. Sometimes you might purge colors out that you didn't even know you had in your bile, so it's very cleansing. They call it the vaccine of the jungle, and
Elductor.
And there's polypeptides, and it helps boost your immune system and amplifies antigens.
Oh, probably.
Okay. So it helps pretty much boost your like immune system. It's really cleansing. It's really beautiful. However, it's very, very intense, and you have to at least drink like 2 gallons of water prior from taking.
Yeah, it swells up your lymph nodes and your face, so you actually look like a frog. And it's done by burning the first layer of skin, and then you put the poison on. And it's like, what, a 1 to 2 hour experience?
It could be anywhere from like 5 minutes to an hour. It depends how long it takes you to purge the first time. For me, when I first did it, I was on my moon cycle. It was very, very, very intense. I literally thought I was going to die. And I was like,
Honestly,
it was bad. I was screaming out, someone bring me a straw, because I need to shove it down my throat, because I thought I wouldn't be able to breathe because my whole face and everything puffed up. Luckily, after about 10 to 15 minutes sitting, I purged out all the things I needed to purge. And then it took about 1 to 3 hours for the swelling to go down. It was a really intense experience. It was beautiful. However, I would never do it again on my cycle and do not recommend it. And I see why they say not to do that. And then my second time doing it, it was much more pleasant. When I wasn't on my moon cycle. So that was nice. However, definitely don't do it on your moon cycle. I don't recommend that. And if your practitioner is doing that with the, while knowing that you're on your cycle, you probably shouldn't be sitting with them. Or,
and I did some research through the Reddits. There's a whole ayahuasca community on Reddit. It's r/ayahuasca. If anybody's interested, there's tons of information out there. Tons of people share their stories, all that. But I have read that combos should not be offered in conjunction with ayahuasca so closely. And that was something that was being done.
Mm-hmm.
It's too much purging because you're throwing up a lot with ayahuasca. You're losing a lot of liquid. But if you want to talk about your situation with ayahuasca and that, you know, magical space and how you offered your energy up to facilitate, because that I have no awareness of. I was just I sat. I did not facilitate. So
my first time sitting with the medicine, it was the most beautiful and intense experience I've ever gone through. The first night I was met with my spirit guide, which was the Jaguar. And he or she brought me down this beautiful journey, and I was met with all the conditionings of my past, a lot of mother wounds, a lot of father wounds. At the time, too, I discovered Kundalini energy and felt a burst of it come and rise through my body that was intense.
Oh, I had the Kundalini, too. Holy fuck. Wow.
And I remember at the time I was like, I went up and I was talking to the practitioner. I was like, dude, I'm tripping dick right now. I cannot sit straight. I'm like, I don't even know what to do with myself. Like, I felt like I had to scream, dance, do it all.
Act like an animal on the floor. Literally. That's just what ends up happening. You're just primal.
I was like, I'm not even human anymore. I'm just being. And then, later on that night, I was just purging and crying for my mother, my father, my grandparents, my ancestors, and seeing all the wounds and the pain that they went through, and just asking for forgiveness and praying. And it was beautiful and devastating at the same time. And then the second night, I had the most blissful, beautiful experience. I felt what it felt to feel whole and love myself entirely and everyone around me. And it was like love that I've never felt before in my entire existence. And it was beautiful. I was met with Kokopelli in one of my other ceremonies, and that was really intense. He brought me down this psychedelic hallway of like 1,000 doors, and I just walked with them. I was like, all right, here we go. And once I met with the door at hand that he wanted me to walk through, I literally channeled one of my ancestors, and I kind of was like in and out of consciousness, and I was like speaking in another language, and I just became this whole other being. But I remember I was praying for everyone in the circle and for myself, and it was super intense but beautiful at the same time.
Yeah, everybody's energies becomes astral. You're vibrating at such a high frequency that medicine just raises your energy. That's why you're throwing up. You're getting rid of the lower frequencies so that you can leave your body and die. And but you'll come back, but it is a death. And it's very similar to birth, but everybody's energies literally is just flowing in the room, and the room is contracting like the Big Bang, or like a womb or a breath. There's a cadence to it. There's a rhythm. Yeah.
Yeah, that's exact. Like the first night of that journey with Kokopelli, I felt like a butterfly in a cocoon, and I knew that eventually, like the second night, I was going to become the butterfly. And that's exactly what happened. And I was like, wow. And after that ceremony, I told myself, I'm going to wait a very, very, very long time until I sit with the medicine again, because that was more than enough for for me.
I'm good for life. I'm good for life. Yeah. I will wait till death and I will re-experience that. That's
so let me ask you this. So after doing that, how many years ago was it you guys did this?
This was about, for me, 3 years ago.
I was 2022, March of 2022.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it was like, it was like two, three years ago. Okay. So since all of that, how would you say that experience has changed A, your life as just everyday, you know, life, and B, how has it changed your witchcraft?
I could bring them.
I'll be back in like 15 minutes.
What happened? We can't hear her.
Uh-oh. You can't hear Anya?
Now I can hear you.
Wait, no, we can't hear Anya. We cannot hear Anya.
I can't hear Anya.
Can you hear me?
Oh, no. I think Amber walked away.
Here. Take this one.
Oh, okay, perfect.
Because I got to sit with her for a second.
Okay. So the question was just
a baby.
Was how did it change your life outside of witchcraft? Just your everyday mumble. And how
they both work.
Okay. Yeah, but she can't hear
on this one.
I don't know what's going on.
Okay, it's whatever. Just let's see if they can hear you now.
Sorry, her, my father-in-law went to the store for a couple minutes, so I have to sit with her.
Hi.
We're gonna talk about some stuff. It's gonna be great.
I know you, crabby. I lost my train of thought.
I know you lost your train of thought.
Yeah, I got distracted.
I would talk about facilitation, like what that entails.
Oh,
I'm gonna go in the other room.
Okay.
But here, just talk about what it entails, and I'll be right back.
So how did it change your life, like as an everyday person, but also how did it change your witchcraft after the fact? Like cleaning up puke
buckets. So as an everyday person, it really helped me. So I'm going through my Saturn return right now, at the moment, and I'm kind of grateful that I've experienced working with the medicine, because it kind of like activated and helped me face the things that I needed. A lot doing with my father wounds and my mother wounds, especially because I lost my father at the age of 6 years old. So I grew up without having a dad for most of my life. However, the little memories that I did have of my father, he was always very loving and caring and respectful. But growing up not having that figure, I had to learn how to protect myself. So I learned through the journey with the medicine, it's taught me a lot about myself, the wounds that my mother has gone through, learning about my father through the spirit realm. I started getting visions and connected to divinity through dream work. So I get a lot of messages from my angels and my spirit guides through sleep. And I thought that was really interesting. And then through that, I started working with witchcraft a little bit and meeting Amber at the time. It was about like 4 years ago. I asked her about, oh, so what's your thoughts on this herb or this plant or these things that, you know, that dealing with witchcraft, because she is of Haitian tradition. And I noticed that through the time working with different plant medicines and herbs and stuff, it really helped me connect with myself and rediscover me as a person that I am today. So.
Okay, so let me also ask you this, because I know we talked briefly before the show, because I was talking about Cuban coffee, but originally your heritage is from Cuba. And you came to here when you were born here, but your parents came here at what year?
So my parents came here in 1992. So I was born 2 years. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so you were
born in 94.
In 94.
So a couple years. Yeah. A couple years after.
Okay. So now when you were talking about journeying and you're talking about all these things, you're talking about talking to ancestors and stuff like that. Did you have to go through a lot of the pain that they went through in Cuba and all those things that happened? Like, was that traumatizing for you as, you know, Cuban descent to learn? I know you probably already knew, but learn really and see what they all went through to be where you are today.
Like, yes.
How did that affect that?
Yes. So back after my first ceremony, I was gifted the moment of facing what my mother went through and what my father went through and how much they had to sacrifice in order for me to be here today. And feeling that pain so deeply was just so, oh gosh, it was like almost too much. It was devastating. And realizing that, wow, they had to sacrifice their whole existence, their whole life, family, their like my mother grew up with my grandparents being farmers, and they helped and gave a lot to the community. And after communism happened and my father being a political prisoner, my mother had, you know, one or two choices: either stay in Cuba and deal with this suffering, or leave and have a new life. And so my family sacrificed their whole, you know, everything that they had just to be here, just to have a second chance. And then feeling that, you know, even though I didn't go through that pain, but I felt what they went through over the years growing up and what the medicine has shown me, I was like, wow, like they gave up a lot just for me to be here and have a decent life. And that's helped me a lot with, you know, character development and respecting medicines and witchcraft and other things and beings and things of that nature. And that's what made me dive into like facilitating and helping other people through their journey work and things of that nature. So
yeah, because it's very like a trauma healing, like ancestral trauma, and really helps you identify who you are. I mean, it's interesting to think about magical medicine in that way, because it's almost like breaking down those mental constraints that we learn as, you know, we get older and move through the world, and these things can be tools to let us experience things that we may not otherwise be able to, and help us grow and heal things. So I think that that's beautiful.
Yeah. And I, you know, I'm going to be the first to say that I, you know, took history class as like a free for all where I could just fart off and do nothing and be a social thing, you know? So when they talked about Cuba and they talked about things that happened there, I honestly didn't pay attention. And it wasn't until I started working where I work now, where one of my physician's assistants is from Cuba, and she moved here way after you did. But so she grew up as a young child in Cuba in the 90s. And she would sit at my desk, and I would just, I'm a sponge. I like to learn about different cultures. And she would tell me exactly what it was like in Cuba in the 80s and 90s. And let me tell you, I sat at my desk with my mouth dropped wide open going, because I was just in shock and disbelief at a lot of, I mean, she was just a child, you know? So that's why I wanted to ask that question. Like, cause now I have an insight with that, you know, that PA that I work with, you know, to learn about her culture and stuff, and to be just absolutely shocked because I was stupid and didn't pay attention in school when they taught a lot of those things that happened. But also in school, they don't tell you.
I feel like a lot of the stuff, I was going to say that, that in school too, I don't think, because I feel like there's only so much insight that they,
they can actually tell, that they can actually safely tell you in education.
Right.
But with that being said, even the safe stuff that they're allowed to teach you, I didn't pay attention to. So she told me the stuff that I had already learned. But then when she got into detail and told me the stuff that they don't teach us, I was just, I mean, my heart just was like, I couldn't. And to see this, this person go from that to become, you know, to go to medical school and become a physician's assistant, you know, basically a nurse practitioner is what she is. She's like, you know, like basically one step below a doctor. It's kind of like one of those things. You're just like, you just were like proud of her. You never grew up with her, but you're just like to see someone actually come here at the age of 18 or 17, she was, and just reach for the stars, and to hear like what it was like to where she lived. And that was normal for her. And I'm just like, no, that's not normal, you know? And she's like, well, now I know that now, but she's telling me these stories that a lot of us were just in disbelief. So that's why I wanted to ask that question, because you journeyed through your ancestors. So you saw all that even before the, you know, 80s and 90s, what Cuba was like. And it's just one of those things where I just was kind of curious if you had to feel that pain and go through that.
I've realized with working with the medicine too, a lot of these memories, a lot of these experiences, they're all in our DNA. We carry them, right? So when I was journeying with the medicine, I saw a lot of the things in the moments where my mother, my father, my grandparents have gone through a lot of pain and moments of like just disarray, just absolute, like the disrespect and the torment that they had to go through living in such a country where they didn't have freedom of speech or were respected or as a human. To be dehumanized as a person is just like unfathomable for me to think of, you know?
But at the same time, to be able to know that now and to feel that and to live that is a whole different thing. And that's where it makes you a that better human, you know, on that different level, you know, to carry that pride, you know what I mean? So I think that is so fucking awesome. So we've got 5 minutes left. Is there anything you guys want to add about your journeying and what you guys experienced?
We'll see if she stays calm. She's ripping apart this toilet paper. That should work. Yeah, but overall, like, plant medicine is extremely powerful, like, well worth it. Definitely the God experience, experiencing source. And like, I didn't even go into detail with that because you can't put it into words.
Yeah.
You can't. It just takes away from it.
Yeah, so Amber did share with me, and if anybody wants the link to it, I can send it to you. Just message me. She did share with me the virtual kind of what it would be like, in a sense. You're never going to experience the full deal with this video, but it can give you kind of an idea of what it's like. And her instructions were to be in a very dark place, you know, with, you know, no lights, no distractions, no nothing, and put the volume up and just sit with this video. And the way she explained it, and she can probably explain it better than I can, is you're going to get the sounds, the experience, the kind of experience without the experience, right? Of what it would be like if you were journeying. So if you want the link, I can send it to you because I have it. And if you're just kind of curious to know before you know, it's a very good experience to kind of go on. It is a YouTube video, but I read all the comments to the video, and every single person that commented said, this is the most realistic video you could possibly ever make on a journey. So if you want to know what it's like just a little bit, I can send you the link, or Amber can send you the link to this video. I highly suggest doing the video if you're interested.
Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
All right. Anything you want to add?
No, very interesting, very insightful, very interesting to hear your experiences. And yeah, I think it's definitely something that's not talked about a lot in this space. No. And I think it's good just to, you know, really touch base with our experiences and how it equates to our spiritual growth, our personal growth, you know what I mean? And connecting with our ancestors and the trauma that we do carry, because I agree with you, we carry that stuff with us. So it's good to really touch base with that and address it. And yeah, I really appreciate you guys being on the show. I think it was fantastic. And thank you for sharing your stories.
Yeah, we love to kind of talk about the things that we don't see in the community talked about as much. Mm-hmm. So when this idea came up to do this herb/psych medicine witchcraft show, we were like, we got to have Amber and Anya on. So I'm so glad you guys made it happen. And we had a little guest star down here tearing up some toilet paper. Into the wine and witchcraft crew. So I just want to thank you guys for doing the episode with us and sharing your 100% truths. Some of it maybe not so happy, but definitely need to be said to give people an idea of what it's like. And I think one of the biggest things that, if this has intrigued you in any kind of way, as Amber has said, make sure you do your research and you have that person there that is licensed, that has done it, that has great reviews, that is actually 100% primo, because you don't want to go down the wrong path with the wrong person guiding you through this, because it's a serious thing. This is not smoking weed, guys. This is something serious that you can seriously harm yourself if you don't have the right guidance to do it the right way. So just because we're talking about it and you're seeing all these cool things that can happen doesn't mean you go buy ayahuasca tomorrow off some black market internet and go try it. Please be safe if you're going to do any kind of psychedelic medicine and witchcraft. Be smart about it. Don't do anything stupid because we want you to come to our show every other Thursday. And if you're dead, you can't do that. So check out Amber's YouTube channel. I hope, Amber, you will continue to do videos sending your journey along the way, because you have so much to say. And I just absolutely love you guys. I think you had so much to contribute to the community, and it's been awesome having you guys on. So thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. It was a blessing to be invited on. Thank you so much. It's so nice to connect with another Massachusetts woman. You have no idea. I am a Massachusetts girl in a New York world, and it's fucking hell.
Right.
I'm saying that.
Yeah. All right, guys. See you soon.
Bye. Bye. Yes,
our next episode is May 2nd, so we'll see you guys then. So bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.